Hi, Beck Mack here for the Independent Survival. Hi, Beck Mack here for the Independent Artist Survival Series, and I am with the one and only award-winning author, Chrissy Neen. How are you, Chrissy?
I am good. I'm really good.
Great to see your lovely face. Now, how are you going in amongst all this madness?
It's been really crazy. I've been super busy. I was busy before we had the lockdown, and I've been even busier since. So it's just, you know, it's a struggle to run from day to day at the moment, but I'm hoping I'll get the rhythm of it soon.
Is this an author's dream to just be, the demand is that you stay at home and don't leave the house? Is this what you've been looking for all your life?
It would be if I didn't also have to do my job.
Oh, yeah.
So unfortunately, I'm kind of trying to be and have an author's life as well as run the entire events program of the bookshop I work for from home as well. So I haven't got the demarcation of when to shut off the day job. I had that down when I was going to work because I wasn't looking at my emails when I went home. But now that we have to do a lot more work to save that program, it's basically been like working full time for the day job and trying to squeeze little tiny bits of writing time. So I'm actually just in the process of trying to work out how to make that work again for me.
And I imagine a lot of people are in the same situation where their home life, their relationship life, their family life is now completely merged with their work life, and finding the boundaries around that would be quite a challenge. How are you? And I'm going to put my Aphrodite hat on right now. How's your love life going? How's your relationship surviving all this?
That's actually fine because Anthony and I are quite used to working from home together. So even though I used to go to the day job 3 days a week, I had the rest of my writing time at home, and Anthony's a freelance writer, so most of his writing happens at home as well. So we're pretty good at negotiating. We're in a one-bedroom flat, and we're pretty good at negotiating that space together, and we often go away on writing retreats together. So that's been something that we actually do a lot together. So it's been fine. Like, on the home front, everything's absolutely fine. We did have one little snapping period about how messy I am because I was like working at the kitchen table for my avid reader job, and suddenly that became, you know, full of my stuff, and we haven't had this how messy you are fight for many years now, and I was like, oh, this fight's back just for a little afternoon. And I think that's just because, you know, normally I'd go away for 3 days and then I'd come back and I'd clear my stuff and start again. So I didn't have that reset, and I was so busy I just didn't have time to kind of pack my stuff away.
I know, it is actually really hectic inside your house, running between the lounge room, the kitchen and the bathroom 20 times a day. Now, I'm so excited the fact that you're actually doing a series called Lust in the Age of Coronavirus. Can you please tell me all about this, Chrissy? Because if there's anyone who would understand this, I think you would.
Look, it was really because when this first happened, when we first realised there was going to be a lockdown and people were going to be shut at home, I was actually in the process of writing a book, which I got a grant to write, which was going to be about a pandemic. Yay!
Okay. So you had a prophecy.
I've been working on this pandemic thing for about 6 months. Nice. And so I've been writing bits and pieces. I'd spent all of January writing this pandemic. And at the end of January, I started looking at coronavirus and going, maybe I can use some of this in the book and bringing some of the real life into the book. And then suddenly the real life exploded and it became nothing like the book that I was writing. And I realized I actually can't write that book at the moment because I need to untangle the book world from the real life world again, and I need to make it a kind of fantasy version of what's happening in the real life rather than reflecting the real life.
How much was your fiction matching the non-fiction? Like, what were there parallels between what you had written to what you have witnessed now?
Not really, because I was right at the beginning of a pandemic in the book. So it was kind of all contained in a very small space in a, you know, small town in Queensland. And it was where the virus started. It definitely was about the virus switching species. So I'd gone through this whole thing about reading up about how viruses could kind of jump between species. And so I'd done all that. But the book itself was more, in a way, it's kind of reflected real life in that the book was quite a positive book in a way, because even though 10% of people died who got the virus, the people that survived it were connected into the natural world. So I had this kind of urge to connect with nature. So it actually changed us physiologically so that we were actually a more environmental species. And so that's really what the book was about. And in a way, that's happening, because as we lock ourselves down, we're realizing that the environment is coming back and that we're actually, you know, we need to protect the environment. So all of that stuff is happening, but it's not happening in the way that I was having it happen in the book. So it became this thing where I just went, look, I've got to step away from the book. I've got to put it down for now, but I still want to keep my actual creative writing practice. I don't want to get sucked into just doing, you know, events programs. And also I've been doing a bit of film work, and I was like, that's all I've got now. I don't have my book. So I really quickly went, okay, I still want to engage with the pandemic in some way, but I want to engage with it in a way that I can just focus on it. And yet I don't want to write a terrible book about how people start getting the virus and then die. So I thought, look, I'll use a skill that I've got, which is writing erotic fiction. I know I can do that. I know that I enjoy doing that. And I know that it's a bit of a fantasy away from the everyday when you write erotica or read it. So it's something that people might want to read. And if I write a story every week based on what's happening with the coronavirus and with the pandemic, and I write one story every week, it will reflect what's going on in the real world, and I'll just be weaving that back in to my story world, and I can follow the virus moving forward, but I can also do it in a way that's enjoyable, because each week is an erotic story about somebody else in lockdown in this world, and that will just kind of bring the new restrictions in as they happen and the new things that are happening in Australia. So it will be social commentary, but it will also be erotica and enjoyable, and people will be interested in it. And I thought the only way to make myself actually do it every single week is to do it publicly, because otherwise the temptation is, I'm just too busy, I can't get my head around it, I won't do it this week. So I just decided that I would make it a public reading once a week.
Because I think I interviewed an artist today called Ian Sinclair, and he was describing a piece of work he's doing called Skin Thirst, where like the world become, you know, some of us who are say single or separated from our loved ones, like the need to touch, the need to embrace, the need for sensuality will be completely heightened. So I imagine this is a whole new terrain of reserve and resist and disable in a way that you can explore the erotic world in. Is this sort of where you're going? What are you finding in there, Chrissy?
Yeah, I mean, each week brings a different story, and it's all kind of inspired by what's happening. So the first week I wrote a story called Mr. Gelati, which was about our need to order out. And it was still hot. It was still really, really hot. So I need the idea that gelato would be something that we would need in the heat, but you'd have to order for it. And Italy was going through its crisis. And so the gelato deliverer was an Italian guy who obviously had something going on in his backstory, although we don't know what it is. And so I brought that into it. And so basically it was about someone who was who'd come back from overseas, was self-isolating, what got some gelato delivered, and basically was fantasizing about the gelato deliverer at home alone. And so that was the first story. And the second one, I'd been listening to the CoronaCast like crazy, you know, the Dr. Norman Swan's CoronaCast. Yeah. So the second episode became Dr. Norman Swan, and it was about someone who listens to Dr. Norman Swan's CoronaCast, and that dulcet Scottish accent that he has becomes the subject of her fantasy. So basically it's a masturbation story with coronavirus. What's that?
I want to... Now you're talking about it, I do like the doctor's voice.
Voice, I have to admit. So it was pretty. That was pretty fun to write, and it was really fun to read that one. And I'm moving on. The story for this week is about someone who buys a bidet because toilet paper is still not in the shops, and so you know the idea that a bidet you know, is something that you might be able to rock back and forth on and have a bit of a nice time on, is something that you can kind of add to that, I suppose. So at the moment, things are quite light and fun and enjoyable. And I imagine that they will move through a period of darkness. So I imagine that I will move to darker places as Australia starts to realise the implications of, you know, what it's going through at the moment. But at the moment, the death toll is smaller than in other countries. And it's more about the anxiety at the moment. We're going through this period of grief and anxiety, I think. Mm. And so that's really, that's simmering away in the back of these stories. And I'm sure that they will go to dark places, and I'm hoping that they'll move out of those dark places into a reconnection with others. And when we're let out to finally, you know, be free in the world.
And actually have real sex. Yeah. That side of Zoom sex, I reckon, is the new industry that's possible. everyone will be hot and horny back then, you know.
I think it's going to end in a giant orgy.
Woohoo! That could be your final story. But you're right. I guess when you look, say, particularly at New York, like the insanity of what's going on there, and I imagine particularly, well, the whole community is being greatly affected, and also the creative community there would be losing some really amazing artists and people, and we haven't even got to that place yet. Like, we are just, I guess, grieving over what we've lost personally in our opportunity, our money, our relationships. We've yet to face the cost of losing lives on many levels. I think that will be the next thing. But within your own industry, Chrissy, within what's happening there, like what's been the impact of COVID-19 on your personal industry?
It's been terrible to see people whose books are being released into the world, and that they had these big book tours planned, you know, light boxes in the airports for some people's books. You know, the first time someone would have had one of those big sort of advertising light boxes, and yet they can't appreciate that because, you know, no one's going to the airports and their light box is there in an empty airport by itself. So, you know, you kind of, my heart goes out to these people whose books are being released now and are having to kind of suddenly move all of their touring to an online platform. And the people in the first week, I feel most sad for, because it's before anyone had actually managed to kind of get on top of the technology. Now I know that we're running events with authors, at least online, so there's a little bit of action going on there. But it's really devastating for them, because it's really the launches and the book tours that sell those books and make people know about them.
And also, but those writers' festivals are cancelled as well, so it's an opportunity for people to come together with their networks and with their cohort and connect and talk, and so you sort of lose all that, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. And I mean, I was going to go to this year's Sydney Writers Festival. I was booked in for 4 events there. I know other people who, you know, were doing their launches there at Sydney Writers Festival, and that's just devastating that was, you know, closed and no one can do that. But again, you know, the grants just came out, and I see that, you know, that the Sydney Writers Festival has lost their funding, the Brisbane Writers Festival has lost their funding. So, you know, it's like, it's something that was in the pipeline anyway. This, all of those kind of cuts to the industry were planned by the government before this happened. So despite the fact that the government has finally come around and is actually doing something really positive, which is supporting people's wages while they have none and trying to stop social unrest that way, they had all these kind of really, really nasty cuts for the arts, you know, in back pocket during this period of time. So, you know, I don't cut them any slack, because they were totally wanting to gut the arts, and it's happened regardless of coronavirus. The gutting has happened.
Considering all the billions that are part of the package, like, there's not so much going directly to the arts as such. It's people's income and what wages are lost. But this, you know, that what a great opportunity to actually really fund the cultural sector right now with the funds that are coming through. And it seems like the arts are still missing out. Are you thinking the same thing?
Yeah, well, look, it's the artists who have actually raced in and who are doing all this stuff that is actually going to keep people from going stir crazy during this time. The artists are the ones who are organising festivals, online festivals, who are organising, you know, readings, organising house parties, organising music festivals online. But it's all for free. You know, it's all without any kind of income. So even though there's all this activity that is happening at the moment, it's yet again artists doing their work without money, and most of them are doing it on the on the job seeker allowance, which is doubled. That's fantastic, but you know that is what they're doing. They're doing it from an unemployed position, and I think that's going to be really, really hard to come back from at the other side, because people are so used to getting their art for free during this time when they're actually just logging on and there's art for free. They won't want to pay for this content, and they won't want to support the artist, because there'll be this expectation that I just turn on my computer and everything's free for me. I don't get to pay for it.
So what, from your perspective, are the options at this point? Because we are at a tipping point where everyone has got frantic and is putting out as much content as they can. And you can sense it's trying to find a way through, like you've lost 6 months of work, a year's work, to find your audience and to be relevant. But there is that, the other side of it, as you're saying, that people are just generating and giving away content for free. Like, what do you think from your perspective is the balance of that, and what would be the best way forward for the creative sector as a whole?
I think that we have to do this work for free at the moment. Like, I think that it's really important work, and I feel like, you know, I've got a friend in the building that I live in who's a nurse that goes into people's houses and cares for them, you know, like a blue nurse who goes and cares for people in their house and, you know, fixes their wounds regardless of whether they've got coronavirus or not. And that's an essential service. And I feel like what the artists are doing in this time is that kind of frontline essential service. We're stopping a whole bunch of people from, you know, killing their partners and you know, just going crazy and becoming depressed and falling into like a, you know, unsolvable depression. So that's actually frontline service as well. So at the moment we're doing the job that we need to do, which is to kind of provide that content and to provide it for free because people have lost their jobs and can't pay for it. What I'm worried about is that there won't be any acknowledgement of that work at the end of this process. And I think that the government pulling so much funding from the arts sector at the moment is a big sign that as soon as the lockdown is over, they're going to try and hold on to not paying for the arts. Mm. And that's going to be a thing for the future. So I am worried about that.
Do you think also, like, as you're saying, the arts has shifted, the paradigm around the arts has shifted, that the galleries are closed, the theatres are closed, the stores are closed, the festivals aren't on. So artists are finding a new relationship with the community where perhaps they're working on a different level in a different way where they are an essential service, as you're saying. Do you think this hopefully will maybe be a shift around people understanding the importance of the arts as a whole to the community?
I do hope that the people that are on the other end of this that are actually consuming the arts will appreciate the importance of it. I think that they are smarter than our government is. I think we're a smarter nation than our leaders. And I think the people who are watching this art do really appreciate it. And I think that they know that this is stuff that is coming from, you know, people who are putting a lot of effort into it. So I think that those individuals will actually come out the other side with a better appreciation of the arts. So that's one good thing that will come of this. But I just don't have any trust that our government will do the same thing. Yeah. And I think the other thing, you know, the other industry that I'm involved in is the film industry. Mm. And I think that's another case in point too, because I'm writing, you know, stuff for film and TV at the moment, and there's a lot of development happening in this time. So it's not a complete shutdown for people in the writing area, because we're developing stuff, and this is a time when we can develop stuff. But as we go into this lockdown, the government is changing the rules about Australian content on television, and you know, the Australian content in film and TV, there were quotas, and they're removing those quotas just because the providers can't provide enough Australian content because the industry can't make stuff at the moment, so we can't provide new content. So they're trying to remove those quotas, and once those quotas are removed, they're not going to put them back up again. And then we're basically going to have no Australian content, no Australian film industry and TV industry at all at the other end.
That's a really crucial point that you're making, that public, that people know that's happening, because that is really problematic. You know, as you said, once that's happened, it's really hard to reverse those decisions, isn't it?
Well, what they could really do is just say, okay, look, for now, for this temporary period, we remove quotas for the next 6 months. And then after that, it reverts to normal. Yeah. And that would be the way to kind of go, okay, you can provide all this American and US and European content. That's fine. But at the end of it, we need to go back to providing Australian content. And that would support the Australian industry. But what they're doing at the moment is just like blanket saying, okay, it's not workable. Let's remove the quotas. And that is going to kill the industry at the other end.
Very dangerous. But talking about great Australian content, your Lust in the Age of Coronavirus, Chrissy. How do we find it? How do we find it? Listen to it, consume it, get turned on by it? Like, what's the platform? Where is it?
It's Thursday nights, so every Thursday night, and it's on the Avid Reader website. You have to book before 4 o'clock on the day. So you have on every Thursday, you have to log in to avidreader.com.au. Oh, you've lost my...
Yeah, it's just disappeared. I don't know why.
I don't know. It says we've got strong connection here. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, shall I start that little bit again?
Yeah, start that bit again. So tell us, how do we find your Lust in the Age of Coronavirus, Chrissy?
Every Thursday night, I'm reading it live late at night on the Avid Reader website. So through our Avid Reader Zoom. So you have to book in via the website, which is avidreader.com.au, and you have to book in to the sessions, and then before 4 o'clock on the Thursday, and then you'll be sent a Zoom link after 4 o'clock on that day, and you can join in and have a listen.
Oh, that's fantastic. Well, thank you so much for joining me, and it's so good to see you again. And you know, this is going to be hot. This could be, you know, maybe your best work yet. Who knows? Like, sometimes when we're forced into these situations, we come up with the better goods than we could ever imagine. So, but I do want to read your pandemic book, Past in the Future, hey?
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.